This is the last video which is dedicated to the theory behind the design of my new hi-fi power amplifier. Let's quickly recap the previous steps. We started from the design of the push-pull stage, which as you remember is based on two 6V6 power tubes, and here you can see the load lines. We have learned that in order to drive this stage at the maximum power, I need to provide two phase shifted signals, so one 180 degrees apart from the other, the maximum amplitude being 44 volt peak to peak. This is the input voltage to the power tube stage, to the push-pull power tube stage, which drives the push-pull stage to the maximum power. Then we have analyzed several designs for the previous stage, which is the phase splitter. The role of the phase splitter stage is to provide two versions of the same signals to the power tubes stage. The two versions are one at the opposite phase of the other. Again, we have seen different designs with different tubes for the phase splitter. Let's stick with this version. I believe I will utilize this for my project. This is based on the 6NP tube. We have learned that if I provide an input signal to the phase splitter stage, the amplitude being 3.1 volt peak to peak, then the phase splitter provides two versions of the same signal at the output, the amplitude being 44 volt peak to peak, which, as you remember, is exactly what I need in order to drive the output power tubes at the maximum power. So let's now focus on the main scope of this video, which is a description of the theory behind the first gain stage of my future hi-fi power amplifier. As we said before, I need a maximum signal of 3.1 volt peak to peak to be fed to the following stage, which is the phase splitter. And this is my first important requirement for the first gain stage of the power amplifier. The role of this first gain stage is to accept an input signal coming from the preamplifier, for example, and amplify that signal and provide an output signal to the phase splitter, which could be capable to drive the power amplifier at the maximum power. I have chosen a very nice, in my opinion, tube, which is the EF86. I have extensively utilized this tube in all, I would say, almost all my projects, because I really like the sound which comes from this tube. Especially I like to deploy it in a triode-strapped layout, which again sounds so good to my ears. Also, deploying this tube in triode mode lowers a little bit the gain, which is very good, because otherwise we would have really too much gain for a power amplifier. Triode strapped means that the grid number 2 is directly connected to the tube's anode, and the grid number 3 is directly connected to the cathode. We can see here the tube's load line in this triode configuration as provided by the tube's datasheet. And in order to predict the performances, we do the same way as we saw before. So we plot the load line. In this case, I'm thinking to provide 250 volt of high voltage to the tube's anode. And I'm thinking to deploy an 82 kilo ohm anode resistor. I have chosen the operating point you see here for a current of about 2 milliampere, we have an expected gain of 25, more or less, an expected distortion of 0.14%, which is pretty good if you consider that this is predicted at the maximum output swing. So this is the maximum possible expected calculated distortion from this stage. Again, the distortion is calculated through this website, so credits again to this very good website for the estimation of the distortion. As you see, I always tend to drive the tubes a little bit hot, because in my opinion this is the configuration which sounds best. Of course, we always need to check if in these conditions the tube still sits comfortably well within the maximum power dissipation limits. And this is the case. Another check, it's always very important to do, is to verify the maximum input signal amplitude which drives this tube into distortion. In this case, our chosen operating point corresponds to an input voltage of minus 1.88 volt. This is the peak voltage which I can apply to this preamplifier stage before driving to distortion. If I apply an input signal with amplitude greater than this value, the EF86 tube will produce distortion. The amplifier will be driven to maximum power with much lower input voltages to the EF86 stage. Let's calculate that. So let's calculate which is the amplitude value of my input signal which can drive the power amplifier to the maximum power. We have the gain, which is 25. We have the needed output swing, which is necessary to drive to maximum power, which is 3.1 volt peak to peak. So we can calculate that the needed input signal to my EF86 tube needed in order to drive the power amplifier to maximum power is 128 millivolt peak to peak. Pretty low figure, I agree with your thoughts, which I can guess, but we have to consider that till now I didn't apply any negative feedback. I know that negative feedback is something not to be abused, but nevertheless I have always found a little bit of feedback, I would say between 10 and 12 dB, greatly improves the performance of all the amplifiers I have always designed. Of course, we need to closely pay attention to the amplifier stability. I have spoken about that in another video, you might want to check that. But yeah, again, negative feedback, a little bit of negative feedback is something which I really like to implement. So, for example, if I apply 10 decibel of feedback, the global gain of the whole power amplifier, including the EF86 stage, the phase splitter stage and the power tube stage, drops, of course, reduces by the same amount, 10 dB. So, according to that, if I apply 10 dB of feedback, the needed input signal in order to drive the power amplifier at the maximum power goes from 128 millivolt peak to peak to 400 millivolt peak to peak, which corresponds to 141 millivolt RMS. If I apply 15 dB of feedback, which maybe for my taste is a little bit on the high side of feedback, then in this case the maximum signal is 247 millivolt RMS. We will see which is the best solution and the best amount of feedback when I will have implemented the power amplifier and I will have done the first listening tests. So this was the last video dedicated to the theory behind this power amplifier design. In the next videos I will propose you the construction phases of my power amplifier, so you will see the application of the theory we have spoken till now. So for the moment that's all. Again, thank you for your attention and see you in the next video.